What's up, guys, and welcome back to Moaning. If you guys are new here, then what is up? My name is Erica. Heya, how you doing? And if you're into the history of the ancient Greeks and the Romans, maybe you're just into the mythology, and maybe you just wanted another Iliad episode which had a little bit more gods in, because you're in the right place. You guys are gonna wanna hit that subscribe button and the bell icon so that you know every single time I post in the future. But onto the topic of today's video, and we are going to be doing book 14 of Homer's Iliad. So why don't we just roll into the video? So if I could summarize book 14 into one sentence, it would be Hera distracts Zeus because she's hot as hell. Which, you know what, we gotta give her a moment. This is her hotness moment. I'm so about it. Even though Hera, problematic as hell, we know this. I am always the first person to call people out in mythology, especially the Iliad, but Hera has a little bit of a glow up and we need to just let her shine. Obviously other like more famous things happen in this book, but like that is the most important thing to me. So let's just begin. The book opens with Nestor. If we remember the last time that we saw old man Nestor, he had brought Machaon back into his tent. Patrick must have gone to see him, remember that? So now we're at that moment where Nestor is sitting in his tent and he's just drinking wine. And there's all of this like battle crying happening from outside. Like people are screaming, they're dying, it's painful. And yeah, Nestor doesn't seem to hear any of this. Whether it's because he's old or he's drunk, it's not actually noted. It doesn't seem like he's drunk, but also I don't think he's that old that he couldn't hear like death happening outside his door, literally. But the only reason why he even notices it is because Machaon, who's injured, right, and he's lying down, he sort of pipes off from the corner and he's like, hey Nestor, you hear that? You might wanna go and like help out instead of just drinking wine. So without saying anything, Nestor just like gets up to get himself together, right? So he picks up his like bronze spear and he picks up this bronze shield, which this is just a note that I have made and that I continue to make every single time I read the Iliad, that Nestor picks up this shield and Homer notes that it's his son's shield. However, two lines later, they tell us that his son was actually given the shield by Nestor. So it's really Nestor's shield, but we're told that it's his son's shield that then was given to him by Nestor. So why don't we just start this whole description by saying that it's Nestor's shield? I feel like there's just detail in there that we didn't need. But regardless, Nestor picks it up, okay? He picks it up and then he leaves the tent. And when he's standing outside the tent, he has a moment where he's thinking, am I gonna go and help everybody? Or should I go and talk to the old heroes? Not like the old heroes, but the heroes who were injured, right? So should he go and talk to those people like Diomedes and all of that? And he stands there and he deliberates for a bit and then he's just like, yeah, I'm gonna go find them. So he walks off to the edge of the camp and he ends up stumbling upon Diomedes, Odysseus and Agamemnon as they're all sort of like standing about and they're talking and they're by the ships. And we do get a description of why the ships are moored in a certain way, but I'm not gonna give it to you, but just that you know it is in the book. Little details, Homer gives us all of them. So as Nestor is approaching, Agamemnon sees him, and Agamemnon initially turns around and he's a bit like, excuse me, why are you not in battle? And the reason why he's a little bit aggressive initially, he goes on to explain this, and he does say that it's because he's terrified of Hector. He says that Hector has not made it subtle that he really wants to like burn the Greek ships, okay? He's been screaming up from the rooftops. And so because of that, Agamemnon is worried that he won't stop until he achieves that. Now that is Agamemnon's main fear, and it's good. We like it that he's highlighting, this is where my fear is coming from. This is like a very therapeutic moment for me to read. I'm just like, yes, Agamemnon, tell us your root feelings. If Hector does achieve this though, Agamemnon is mostly terrified that then the Greeks are gonna hate him in the same way that Achilles hates him, because that is his main problem. He's like, Achilles hates me so, so much. I would hate for the rest of the army to hate me this much because I'm not in there helping them make sure that Hector doesn't take down the walls, doesn't burn the ships, all of this sort of shebang. And as he's listing these things off, Nestor is like, well, got some bad news for you. Yeah, Hector took down the walls and he took down the gate and it's like not pretty over there. But he does try to assure Agamemnon not to freak out. And he's like, you can't just jump back into the battle. All of you guys are injured. It would be absolutely useless to have you in there. So what would make more sense actually is if we stand here and we come up with a plan, we devise a plan of a way you guys can help with the battle without actually getting in there and being even more injured. Now this obviously doesn't stop Agamemnon from freaking out. He's just like, oh, okay, so the walls are gone, the gate is gone, the ditch didn't even help because they had dug that massive ditch outside. So he's a bit like, you know what, this is clearly Zeus sending us a sign that we are not supposed to win. We're all fated to die, we can't fight Zeus. And he is really smart in realizing that it's not that they're fighting the Trojans, it's that they're now fighting a god. And because of this, Agamemnon's like, look, we should all cut our losses and we should just go home. Which is like the fourth time that he's said this, right? He's said this multiple times throughout the book. Initially it was to trick everybody, and now it's just more and more he's like, we should just go home, we can't win this, this is getting insane. Now Odysseus is standing there leaning on his spear and he does not like the sound of this, okay? And he even looks at Agamemnon and he goes, what the f are you talking about? And he starts saying how much he hates Agamemnon because he's like, I really hate that Zeus put you in charge of all of us. I really hate that you're the one who's leading us into battle and you're the one who's gonna get all of the glory if we win and all of this. But you need to not say that too loudly, because what if other people hear you and what if they start moving to go home? So you need to pipe down and I hate your heart right now. Like literally he says, I hate your heart. And Agamemnon, it's actually really sweet because he replies and he's just like, that really hurt my feelings, Odysseus. I gotta say, I don't like Agamemnon, but that's like kind of a cute moment for him. And instead of like having Odysseus reply, because Odysseus is about to, and he's just like, ah, no, you just really hurt my feelings and I feel really bad about myself. So someone else tell me something that I'm gonna wanna hear. So who pipes up then? But my main man, the love of my freaking life, Diomedes stands up. Well, he is standing already. He's leaning on his spear, but he sort of straightens up. And he tells us right now that he is actually the youngest of all the men in this group. So of the four, of Agamemnon, Odysseus, him, and Nestor, he's the youngest. I like these little notes where we can sort of just like understand how old everyone is and sort of like what their rank is. So that's just, I wanted to pass that on to you. Then he goes on to say his whole like family history thing or whatever, which you don't need to know. But he says that because he's like, what I'm about to say, then you can't like dishonor it because I come from this great family. My dad is really great. We know how much everyone loves Tydeus. They will not stop talking about him. So that is basically what he stresses in this moment, that he's just like, let me talk and just like give me one second. In his one little moment, Diomedes actually tells them that he thinks it would be in their best interest to get back into battle, but not fighting. He says, we should go down to the army. We should encourage them. We should help them. We should give out the appropriate weapons, all of that sort of stuff. Be there for support rather than for actively fighting because they're all injured. You know, Diomedes himself, right? He can't like put weight on his foot because stupid Paris's arrow is in it. So, you know, he can't do that, but he's like, we should go down and help them at least and encourage them. And the other heroes actually really like this idea. All of them agree and they all start to walk away. As they're walking away, Poseidon comes down. He disguises himself as an old man and he sort of like tugs on Agamemnon's hands, that Agamemnon turns around and he says to him like, just so that you know, in this moment, because all the Greeks are getting slaughtered, Achilles is no doubt super happy about it. Because bear in mind, this is important to remember, that Achilles wanted them to suffer. Achilles literally asked his mother, make sure that Zeus helps the Trojans win so that they realize how valuable I am. This is all happening because he's a petty bitch. I just want to highlight that again. But either way, so that is what Poseidon as an old man says to Agamemnon, and he basically tells him like not to fret because he's like, it's fine. At the end of the day, we know that the Greeks win and that you will end up pushing them back to Troy, the Trojans back to Troy. You will end up doing that. So just bear with. I can't tell you how it's gonna happen, but it will happen. Just relax. Poseidon then turns around. He does this really weird thing where he just like screams. I always wonder how Agamemnon has reacted to this, that Poseidon is like, hey, you should do this, blah, blah, blah. Turns around. Like, what a weird reaction. But he does turn around and he screams. And it's described as being like the volume of like 9,000 men. This is the same description that we have of Ares in book 5 when he screams too. So it's sort of like the same thing going on here. So he screams, and when he screams, apparently that's like the energy that then like transfers into all of the Greek soldiers. So all of them are suddenly like ready for battle because of this scream. Again, I don't know the science behind it, but that's what Homer tells us. It kind of, if you guys have seen Game of Thrones, like season 8, right? Okay, like the last like 2 episodes or whatever. I'm sorry, I'm gonna ruin a few. It was trash anyways, it's fine. But when the dragon like burns the Iron Throne, it does this whole like sort of thing. That is how I picture Poseidon, as that dragon with the fire, but instead of the fire, it's just like encouraging battle frenzy, right? I don't know if that made any sense, so we're just gonna move on because now we cut to Olympus, which is great. Okay, so we cut to Hera on Olympus and she's looking down at the Greek side and she can see Poseidon doing his little thing. So she's pretty happy about it. Bear in mind, she's the side of the Greeks. So she's like, great, Poseidon, keep doing you. Then she turns to see Mount Ida. She can see Zeus and he is obviously not happy because he's on the side of the Trojans. And he also is just like never happy in this book. He is in generally a very bad mood the whole time. Hera notices this and Hera is like, bet you I could change that. So Hera comes up with this great plan that she's going to make Zeus less hateful by making herself really hot and hopefully distracting him enough that he wants to sleep with her. Basically, that's her plan, which is a solid plan, I gotta say. Considering Zeus's background, considering his mythology, I can see this working. We all see the logic of Hera. So she goes to her chamber, she gets all ready, she like washes her body with ambrosia, she puts this like really nice sweet olive oil on. She then puts on this like dress, this like beautiful robe that has been woven by Athena. And there's like this beautiful like gold brooch that she like seals it with. The middle part has like all these tassels. She puts on these earrings that are like triple droplets. I just just like love that little like detail. And then the finishing touch is this like veil, because you know it's like uber sexy to have like a veil in front of your face. Like, so that is Hera's vibe, and she's looking like hella hot. Like you're reading it, and it's like one of those scenes in a movie where like the main character gets like a massive blow up, and you're like, yes, bitch, do you? So after Hera looks fantastic, she then calls on Aphrodite, and she's like, I know that we're on opposite sides of the wall, but I need you to do a favor for me. Is it possible that you would do that despite us being on opposite sides of the wall? To which Aphrodite says, that has nothing to do with us, so if you need a favor from me, what's the favor? Let me see if I can do it. So Hera basically lies flat out to Aphrodite's face. Basically, she does. She literally lies, and she says, I need you to help me with this whole, like, desire thing. So you gotta make me look super hot. I don't know how you do it, but I need you to help me because I need to go and get these two gods called Oceanus and Tethys. I wanna hook them back up. So if I go and I have all this like desire on me, hopefully it will be inflicted on them. They'll then hook up. It's in all of our best interests if they get on anyways. So yeah, that's the plan. Which is a bunch of baloney, okay? Hera has no intention of doing this, but obviously she can't tell Aphrodite what she's actually gonna do, because if it was going to be, hey, I'm gonna mess with Zeus, everybody would be like, huh? No. So as expected, Aphrodite hears this, she kind of laughs, and she goes, yeah, sure, I'll help you with that. And she gives Hera this breastplate that she wears, which is where all of her desire is in, apparently. It's like this magical breastplate thing. And she gives it to Hera, and she's like, hey, hide this underneath your robe, and anything that you want to do, like anything that your heart desires, it's a much better way of putting it, will not go unaccomplished. Like, you will achieve it. So like, don't worry, just wear this thing and you're good. And Hera's like, peace out, and she leaves. Now, even though Hera is equipped with the breastplate now, there's still one more piece of the puzzle that she needs before she can go and see Zeus. So she first of all stops on Lemnos, and she hangs out with the god Sleep. Now when she approaches Sleep, she's like, yo bro, what's up? I need you to do a massive favor for me. I need you to put Zeus to sleep after I hook up with him, because he needs to be asleep so that we can make some progress on the Greek side on the battlefield. Please, that would be great. And if you're willing to do that, she does bribe him. Obviously she bribes him. So she says to Sleep, if you do that, then I will have my son Hephaestus make you this really nice gold throne and this really nice like footstool so that you can just like chill the fuck out whenever you want. It will be really pretty, I promise. I don't know if it counts as a gift from Hera if she's going to instruct her son to make it. I just want to throw that into the episode. But she does offer that, and Sleep doesn't bite. He is sitting there and he's just like, you want me to fuck around with Zeus so that you can do something on the battlefield? Hell no, because Sleep is terrified of Zeus. And actually, Sleep tells us the story that this has happened before. This is the best thing. So apparently during the first siege of Troy, you guys don't need to know the details of the first siege of Troy, but there was one. So Heracles was part of the first siege of Troy, who's also Hercules. Hercules is the Roman name, Heracles is the Greek name, same dude. So he was part of this, and he is Zeus's son. Now Hera hated Heracles famously, so she had instructed Sleep to put Zeus to sleep in order to derail Heracles on his little task, because she was like, your life has to be miserable and difficult. Yeah, so apparently when Zeus woke up and he realized what had happened and how Hera had done this whole thing to Heracles, he was like not happy. And he tore through Olympus, apparently tore through the entire mountain, the entire neighborhood, looking for Sleep. He was like, I'm literally gonna kill this god if I ever find him. And Sleep was so scared, okay? This poor man is running around because Hera told him to do something that Zeus was obviously not gonna be happy with. But the only way he lived through it was because Nyx, who's the goddess of night, Nyx actually found him and like shielded him from Zeus, because Zeus is terrified of Nyx. And I love that little detail that when he found out that Sleep was with Nyx, he was a bit like, okay, fine, you can just stay there. That's okay. I'm done with my punishment now. Because he didn't want to with Nyx. And I love that. We don't get any mythology from Nyx apart from these like odd little lines. And that is my favorite one about her, because she must have been a beast. But this episode isn't about her, so let me just, anyways. Hera then pulls out the big guns because she really, really needs Sleep's help. And so she says to him, hey, if you help me, I promise I'm gonna get one of the three graces to marry you. That one that you think is really hot, I'll make sure that you can marry her. And obviously Sleep is just like, what? You can do that? Are you for real? Swear on the river Styx. Like, he fancies the crap out of this one of the three graces that he makes Hera swear. Hera does swear. And so he's like, fine, I'll do whatever it is that you want because I get a really hot bride at the end of this. So together from Lemnos, they fly off to Mount Ida. And when they get there, Sleep has to sort of like hide in the forest because obviously Zeus can't know that he's there. Otherwise Zeus will know that something's up. So he sort of just like melts into like the pine trees. And he's like, oh no, oh goodness. Meanwhile, Hera, looking hot as hell with a breastplate and everything like that, and Sleep in his place, she then goes up to see Zeus. And when she gets up there, it's described, like Zeus's reaction is described as right before they had hooked up for the first time. That it's like the first time he's like really realizing how much he fancies her again. And he's just like, whoa,
what are you doing here? Like, this is a really nice surprise.
He also points out how she doesn't have her chariot or her horses with her, which he thinks is really weird. So Hera has to clarify and pretend, right, remember this is a whole ruse, pretend that they are at the bottom of the mountain. And then she relays the lie again that she told Aphrodite. So she's like, oh, well, I'm just stopping by before I continue on to Oceanus and to Tethys. I'm trying to hook them up again. I just wanted you to know. I wanted you to be in the know because I'm a great wife and I wanted you to know what was going on in my life. And that's really why I'm here. So that way you know that I have a totally innocent plan, which obviously strokes Zeus's ego because he's like, oh my God, my wife is so great. She's just coming here to like chit chat to me. So I'm in the know, knows the people behind my back. I'm obsessed with this. So he basically thanks her and he's just like, thanks for letting me know. But there's time for you to do that later because you are super hot right now and I think that we should hook up because I've never been more attracted to you in my life. And then he does the most Zeus thing. It's the weirdest thing, but it's the most Zeus thing. He literally lists off like all the women that he's cheated on Hera with. Questionable. And then says, yeah, but you're hotter than all of them combined right now, so we should definitely hook up. And if Hera wasn't there on a mission, you know she would have flipped right then and there. I would have, like, I think anybody would have been like, really? Really gonna tell me of all the other women that you've had sex with when you're also telling me that you want to have sex with me. It's just a choice that Zeus makes. But Hera doesn't bite, thankfully. She instead tells him that she wants to actually go back to her chamber because she's like, well, if we hook up here, then all the gods can see because my Ida's like right out in the open. If we go back to my chamber, it's like private and I would like much prefer it. And Zeus is like, oh, nah, don't worry. I'm just gonna make this like gold cloud and we can hook up in the cloud, which is so thick that not even Helios can see through it. Helios, the sun god, which is just the most fantasy mythology. I'm losing all of my words. It's just one of the strangest descriptions because then they hook up in a golden cloud, which you're like, okay. And right after that, right on cue, sleep comes out and he makes Zeus fall asleep, which is fantastic. And after he does that, he then runs down to Poseidon, who's on the Greek side of the camps. He's still down there. And he runs down there and he says to Poseidon, look, dude, me and Hera have roused this whole plan. We now need you to rally up the Greek soldiers so that you can all go into battle while Zeus is asleep, because as soon as he gets up, he's gonna be mad. Poseidon hears his cue though. He stands up on a boat. He starts yelling at all of the Greeks and he's just like, you guys are gonna be great soldiers. Maybe not as great as Achilles because he's still in his tent and he is the best soldier, but you guys can probably do close to Achilles if you trust what I say and do exactly as I say. Which once again, this is just there to remind us that Achilles is still not on the battlefield because he's petty. But that's what Poseidon says, and all of the Greek army, obviously they all like cheer and they're like, yeah, let's go. And as they're all gonna get ready for battle, we actually have Diomedes, Odysseus, and Agamemnon who are handing out the appropriate weapons to the appropriate fighter. So this is actually really helpful of them because they're saying, you know, like this person is better at this, so I'm gonna give them this weapon, and this person needs more armor, and this person needs more this, and this person needs more that even. So that's their role. It's exactly what they said earlier, that they're just sort of helping delegate weapons to the appropriate soldiers. And then all the Greeks walk out onto the battlefield area of where they're fighting. All the Trojans come out, they face off, and then they fight. Now the first and most important encounter on the battlefield is between Hector and big Ajax. Remember, they got beef, okay? So this was like bound to happen. So basically Hector comes out, he sees big Ajax and he's like, I'ma kill that man. So he fires his spear at big Ajax, at the wall of the Achaeans. This is obviously not gonna go well. So Ajax actually, in this moment, he's got these two straps around him which cross over in the middle. And that's because one is for his shield and one is for his armor, right? This makes total sense. They're like this over his body. And where Hector fires the spear, it actually hits right where they intersect, right where they cross over on the front. So even though it hits Ajax, it doesn't actually hit him. It just more so like stuns him because he has all of the armor layers anyways, and then these two thick leather layers that are then preventing the spear from getting any further. So it doesn't hit Ajax, but it makes him really f***ing mad. And what Ajax does is he leans down, picks up a rock, and he lobs it at Hector. And this thing is huge. And it hits Hector like right in between the neck and the chest. So I don't know what side it is, it doesn't tell you, but it hits him on one side. And when this rock hits him, he ends up like spinning, kind of. So he's more like a spinning top, just because where the rock hits him, it sort of pushes that side back. He spins around and he falls to the ground. So obviously all the Greeks see this as their chance to finally kill Hector and they're like, yes! And they all start throwing their spears at him whilst he's like knocked the fuck out on the floor. Luckily for Hector though, a lot of the other Trojans obviously see this, like Sarpedon, Glaucus, all of those sorts of people. They then come forward, some with their actual shields to shield Hector, and some are just fighting off the Greeks, and a bunch of them go in and drag, not Greeks, Trojans obviously, they go and they drag Hector out of there, put him on a chariot and have the chariot sort of ride back towards Troy. But it doesn't make it to Troy. Now, Hector on his chariot, once again, he's passed out in the back, and there are lots of other people who are going with him. And they get to the river Xanthus. Now, something I haven't really gone into is the geography of this whole battlefield. There are lots and lots of rivers that are going on. They all have names. We're now at Xanthus, and that is where the chariots stop. So Hector sort of falls out of the chariot, and the guy starts splashing him with water, trying to get him to like come back to consciousness because he's literally near death. So he's getting splashed with water. He finally starts to come round and he has enough strength to get up onto his knees, and then he starts vomiting up blood. It is so gross, and you're literally reading it being like, oh my God, get this man to a doctor. Whilst Hector is chundering in the corner, we then switch back to the battlefield right in that moment that Hector was being driven off. We get right back into that moment. And there's a lot of mini sort of fight scenes that happen, which I'm not gonna mention because you literally don't need to know them. But there's one death which I'm gonna mention because I think it's one of the coolest deaths in the entire book. It's very icky, for lack of a better word. So if you're squeamish, stop watching now. I'm just warning you. There's a warning at the beginning of this video, but I'm warning you again now. So there's a guy, he goes under this name, he's a Greek, okay? Now there is context for this, that sort of, there's a lot of, I was gonna say badgering, but that's not the right word. It's just sort of like they're yelling at each other. There's a lot of trash talking, right? It's really terrible as per normal in this book. So one of them, the guy by this name, one of the Greeks, he gets really riled up by this and he's just like, fuck this. And so he starts to just charge single man against the Trojans. Not like all of them, but like one of them. So he starts running forward. He's got his spear in his hand and he lobs it at this other random dude. You don't even need to know his name. Lobs it at this guy, and where it goes into his face, because that's where the spear goes, it goes below the brow bone, but at the base of the eye. So if you touch your own eye like right now and you can feel like the cheekbone up here, and then there's sort of like that hollow dip. I should be turning this way. Yeah, okay, so that like hollow dip there. The spear manages to get him like right there and then like pop out his eye, but kind of keep the eye because the spear keeps going through his eye socket into the back of his head. So it kind of goes a bit like downwards. Into the back of his head, it severs all of the like tendons and icky in the back of your neck, and the eye is still attached on the end of it. So then this guy, right, the guy beginning with P, he sort of runs in and he chops the guy's head off and he picks it up, but it's still got the spear in it and it's still got the eye in the end of it. And he screams at the Trojans and he's just like, let this man's family know that he was killed on the day that the Greeks sail home victorious. And it is epic. I'm gonna give it to you guys. Like, that is one of my favorite deaths. It's two totally irrelevant people, which is really sad. But at the same time, we're at this point in the book where Homer is getting so creative with his war deaths that I'm just like, yes, give them to me. Like, come on. This makes me sound totally insane, but I'm just someone who like loves war books and war movies. Please don't report me. Anyways, the Trojans shudder in response, naturally, as they should. So they are absolutely terrified. And Homer then sort of breaks the narrative where he evokes a muse and he's just like, oh muse, tell me who had the most deaths of the day. And he sort of runs through all these like big characters and saying like, you know, who they killed and all of this. And we get very familiar names. But the last line, which is the most important, the last line is that apparently little Ajax had the most deaths of the entire day. Apparently he was the best in battle. We don't get a number on it, unfortunately, but he did kill the most people. So obviously that's important to note. But yeah, that's the end of book 14. So thank you guys so much for watching this episode. I do know that a bunch of you were struggling with book 13, which I'm really sorry about that. I tried to do the best that I could. These very like war heavy books, I understand, are really difficult to follow. Even when you're reading it, it's just name, death, name, death, name, death. But I am doing my best. So I do enjoy when you guys DM me about it though. If you guys want to leave a comment, let me know what's working, let me know what isn't. It's all feedback that I use when I plan for future episodes. So yeah, thank you guys so much, and we'll be seeing you next time with more episodes here on Monique. We'll see you then.